In today's video, I'll be explaining Photoshop Smart Objects as they relate to photo editing. But before we get into Photoshop, we need to look at something starting with a RAW file in Lightroom. I've already applied some Lightroom adjustments to this, and I now want to move into Photoshop to work on it further. To do this, you might typically right-click on the image thumbnail in Lightroom. Then in the pop-up menu, you would click the Edit in Photoshop option. This processes the RAW file and then opens the image in Photoshop. Now let's do the same thing, but this time using a Smart Object. I'll right-click on the image as before, but this time I'll come down to the bottom of the menu and choose to edit the image as a Smart Object in Photoshop. Again, this processes the RAW file, but now it's opened as a Smart Object. If you look at the image thumbnail in the Layers window, you can see a small icon to the bottom right. This tells us the layer isn't a regular image, but it's a Smart Object. The reason you might want to do this is to preserve the RAW file editability. What I mean by this is that if we wanted to change any of the existing adjustments, we just double-click the Smart Object. It then opens in Adobe Camera Raw using the same adjustments that I applied to the image in Lightroom. It even keeps things like the healing brush changes as well as the masks that I used. Something that I missed when editing the image in Lightroom though was to level the horizon, so I'll do that now using the Crop tool. I can then select the Level tool and then click and drag to straighten the image. When I click the OK button, Adobe Camera Raw closes and I'm back in Photoshop. Don't worry about seeing this transparent document background if you try this. You can remove it using the Crop tool in the Photoshop Tools palette. The important point to remember is that if I double-click on the Smart Object again, I still have access to the adjustments I made, including to straighten the image. What happens when Photoshop creates a Smart Object is that it acts like a container around the image inside. In this example, Lightroom passed the RAW file data to Photoshop along with all the adjustments that I'd made. Photoshop then converted all this information into a Smart Object. Inside the Smart Object is the RAW file data along with my adjustments. That's why when I double-click the Smart Object to open it, Photoshop loads the RAW file in Adobe Camera Raw. Now let's look at the image we opened as a regular layer. I'm first going to duplicate the layer by right-clicking it because I want to use it for a comparison. Now let's convert the duplicated image layer into a Smart Object. You can do this either in the Filter menu, or you can right-click on the layer and choose the Convert to Smart Object option. As before, you can see the layer now has a Smart Object icon in the corner. Let's double-click this and see what happens. At first glance, you might think nothing's happened, but it has. Photoshop has opened the Smart Object and you're now looking at the image that's inside it. Notice in the Layers window you now only see one layer, which is the contents of the Smart Object. Also, if you look at the tab at the top, you can see this is the background copy PSB image. We still have the document with the two layers open in another tab. What you don't see though is Adobe Camera Raw, because this is a regular image and not a RAW file. Now let's add a levels adjustment to the Smart Object and use it to make a change. I'll then save the changes I've just made to the Smart Object. After that, I can close the Smart Object. When I hide the Smart Object in the document, you can see that it's different to the original layer. But you can't see the levels adjustment I applied because it's inside the Smart Object. If you want to see the levels adjustment again, you need to double-click the Smart Object to open it. Now you can make any further adjustments that you want to and save them inside the Smart Object again. Something else people often don't realize about Photoshop Smart Objects is that you can nest them inside of each other. Let's select the original layer and the Smart Object in this image. I can then convert the two layers into a new Smart Object using the option in the Filters menu. Now when I double-click the Smart Object to open it, I see the layer and the Smart Object inside. Then if I double-click on the second Smart Object, I can see the layers inside of that. As useful as Smart Objects are, there is a downside to using them. They can create a larger file size. You may find that you need to save your images using the Photoshop Large Document format rather than a regular PSD file if you have a lot of layers in them. Smart Objects can also slow the saving of your image files. If you find the files are taking too long to save, you could try saving them in the TIFF format instead. This is much faster, but the files are also much larger. When saving images which use smart objects, it's important to use a file format that supports them, or they will be rasterized into a regular image. You will need to save your images as either a Photoshop PSD, large document, or TIFF file to preserve the smart objects. Another great feature of smart objects is that they can turn a destructive filter edit into a non-destructive one. If I apply a Gaussian blur filter to this regular image layer, there's no way for me to adjust it afterwards. I can only undo the change I've just made and try again with a different setting. Now watch what happens when I apply the same filter to a smart object layer. The filter now appears below the smart object in the layers window in a smart filters section. Now if I want to change the blur setting, I can double click the filter to reopen the dialog. But this doesn't only work with filters, you can also apply adjustments like levels in this way rather than using a levels adjustment. You will also find that some third-party filter plugins, like the Nick Collection from DxO, can work as smart filters. Let's say that I apply my changes to this image using Nick Color Effects Pro. Then when the filter closes, it becomes a smart filter. This means I can reopen the filter by double-clicking and then making any changes to my original adjustments. All my edits, including any control points I've used, are saved as part of the smart object. This doesn't happen when you apply a plugin to a regular image layer. Now let's go back to the image we opened as a smart object from Lightroom. We've already seen that double-clicking the image opens it in Camera Raw, but there are a couple of important points. Let's copy the smart object by right-clicking and selecting the duplicate layer option. You can also press Command and J on your keyboard, or use Control and J if you're using a Windows PC. I'll then double-click to open the new copy smart object. Because this is a duplicate of the original smart object, it also opens in Adobe Camera Raw, and it has the same edits applied to it. The next thing I'll do is to convert this from a color image to a black and white and then apply the changes. As you would expect, the image is now black and white, but look at what's happened to the other smart object. That's also been converted to black and white. The two smart objects are linked so that any change I apply to one is automatically applied to the other. This happens whenever you duplicate a smart object by copying it, and it can have many uses. But if you want to edit a copy of a smart object without affecting the object it's copied from, you need to make a copy in a different way. You can still right-click the smart object in the layers window, but don't use the duplicate option. Instead, choose the new smart object via copy. This creates a new smart object, but using copied data. Now let's double-click to open the image in Camera Raw. We'll then convert it back to color again and close it. Now we have one color smart object and one in black and white. This shows that we can now edit the two smart objects independently of each other. If you're wondering why you might want to do this though, you need to watch this video next. It explains a great technique for editing photos using smart objects. Thanks for watching, and don't forget to subscribe. I hope you'll be back to enjoy more of my videos in the future.